Gary Marcinini, the Dean of the School of Information and Library Science. This event is being co-sponsored by SILS, the UNC Tracks Institute, and the Carolina Health Informatics Program. I'd like to welcome you all, and we're pleased to have Valerie Florance with us today. You know that we have been sort of moving toward this knowledge society for a very, very long time, and it's actually important to know that there's a lot going on campus here as well as around the world. Just this morning, Renzi and the Odom Institute sponsored a really good workshop on data science, and many of you were there or know about it. So there's a lot happening in the space. The thing that I'm so excited about is that this summer there was a strategic planning summary that was announced by NIH for long-term viability and future of the National Library of Medicine. And one of the very important aspects of that report that Francis Collins actually talked about was that the National Library of Medicine will be the epicenter for data science at NIH. And as soon as I heard that announcement, I thought, oh my gosh, we've got to get Valerie Florance to come down here and talk to us about what that might mean for not only our campus, but our schools and for the future. So Valerie agreed, and here we are to hear her thoughts about how this big data world is going to continue to play out from at least an NIH perspective, but I'm sure that you'll hear even broader implications than just the health sciences. Valerie, you've got her little bio here, so I'm not going to read that, but I have a little anecdote. I think it was IR 1995. Valerie was giving a paper there, and Donna Harmon, who was one of the pioneers in information retrieval evaluation, leaned over and said, "You got to keep your eye on her. She's going to be a real leader." And I said, "Okay," and I sort of knew that anyway. So I have kept my eye on Valerie. Valerie has had leadership positions at the University of Utah, at Johns Hopkins University, at the University of Rochester, and now for almost 15 years at the National Library of Medicine. And she's had a huge impact on how we think about information in not just libraries, but beyond. She helped coin and promote the term informationist, which is a term that she uses regularly to describe those professionals who are working in the very information field. So I don't want to take any more time from Valerie. Please join me in welcoming Valerie Florance.
I'm honored to be here. Thank you for a lovely introduction, because I'm here to talk about something I really care about a lot, and I know you do too. So depending on what paper you're reading, you probably think one of these is the right scenario of today. And either science is crumbling and everything is going down the tube, or oh boy, it's rich and wonderful. I'll tell you which side I'm on. I'm here on the positive side. Tell you that up front. I'm not going to tell you it's crumbling. I'm going to tell you this is the best time I can imagine to be a librarian, informatician, a statistician, an informationist, to be whatever you are in this world. There is such opportunity, and people, we're getting a little credibility, right? We have a little window of opportunity here to move into an area that I've always thought belonged to us. So when the National Institutes of Health report came out that said NLM should be the epicenter of data science, I thought, we already know the epicenter of data science. But not everyone knew it, right? They're going to know it. So I'm going to talk about three different related things today. I'm going to talk about the National Library of Medicine because I work there, and because there's exciting stuff going on in the library. I'm also going to talk about the NIH Big Data to Knowledge, or BD2K initiative, as we call it, because that is a change that's NIH-wide. And the final thing is there's a, I want to talk about an NIH initiative that I think is very exciting for all of us. And because I sell cars for a living, I want to talk about funding opportunities that you might someday want to apply for. But I want to start here at the National Library of Medicine, and I'm here on behalf of the library school inviting me, so I'm going to start with this world. So when you think of NLM, you might think of any one or a whole bunch of these resources that are used every day by people all around the world. It could be PubMed and PubMed Central, the full text articles. It could be training that we offer. There are specialized resources that we make available. I'm not going to talk about any of those, so there are plenty of ways to find out more about that. But I thought you might like to see, this only reinforces. So this is a picture. Everybody has used the NIH reporter. If you haven't, go to your health sciences library and get them to show you how. Or find out by yourself. It's either way. Because this is a way you can look at the way NIH funds are distributed into different areas. So this is a snapshot of the way the library spends its budget. And it gives you a sense of the broad scope of activities that go on in our National Library of Medicine, from research, information resources for the public, biomedical informatics research. We have a huge network of libraries all across the country as well. And I want to talk about, because I said I would talk about workforce and research, I want to mention a couple of training workforce-related activities that go on at NLM. One of them is this associate fellowship program. The people who come into this program are people who've just gotten their library degrees. There might be someone in the room who is on the way toward that, and if you are, I want to tell you about this program. So we bring people apply, and those who are chosen come and spend a year at the National Library of Medicine. We have a full curriculum for them that introduces them to the activities of all those different divisions, including mine. We teach them about grants when they come to us. They learn about indexing when they go to the index section. And all during that time, they work on projects with the staff of the National Library of Medicine. So often, by the time they're finished, they have publications to talk and presentations to make because of the new work they've done. Many leaders in the health sciences library community have gone through this program. So if that's the kind of thing that's appealing, just tell me that we bring new people in every year. We also have a famous short course, used to be given at Woods Hole, and now is taught in Georgia. But the curriculum and the faculty are the same. I took this course back before I came to NLM when I was a librarian around the world. And I'll say that it's the best learning experience I've ever had. A group of people who are totally focused and paired up to do projects together a whole week long, just focused on information, health information, and how to manage it and get it to people, design it, every great class. Another case where you apply and if you accept it, we pay. We also have a grant program at the National Library of Medicine, and many people don't think about that. We are part of the National Institutes of Health, and like every other, there are 27 institutes, there are 24 of us give out grants in research and training. And we do too. Our grant budget is the tiniest one. We say we're the smallest, but the most important. For many years, we talked about ourselves as the NSF of NIH, because we are the ones who are funding informatics and information science research. When the rest of the institutes, they were actually funding it in their grants in various ways, but we, not the way we were. I call them the body part and disease people. This is our disease, right? Information is our disease. This is what we study, and this is what we spend our research money on to make the methods and processes. We also have in university-based training programs for people who want research careers in biomedical informatics. We have a broad definition of biomedical informatics that pretty much encompasses everything, including data science and computer science and information sciences and library science applied to fields of biology and medicine. So we have, we train pre and postdoctoral trainings. We also have individual fellowships that can be undertaken to do pre-doctoral training in any other university. It doesn't matter, you define what courses you're gonna take, and if the study section likes your application, then you get a fellowship. You do your research where you are. We also have intramural fellowships and visiting faculty positions. So people can come and work. The library has, I don't think you can see all of them in that photo. So we have two intramural research divisions. By intramural, we mean they're inside the library, and then the library, the researchers work the library, just like researchers are here at the university. And we have, one is the Lister Hill Center, one is the National Center for Biotechnology Information, or NCBI. Both of them have people working on doing research, just like your faculty members are here. And so we have people who will come and spend a year, or spend a period of time doing research with them. I want to talk to you about a unique grant program we have. Nobody else at NIH has it. We love to be different. and this one, we started this in 2012 before data science was actually a phrase that was being used at NIH. In this particular program, we will give a grant to an NIH-funded scientist to bring a librarian or information specialist, it's usually librarians, almost all of them have it, onto their research team to be their expert in research data management and organizing and managing the metadata, all that stuff. So lots of researchers in biology and all those areas don't think about that, right? They're thinking about the part of the science they're interested in. Then they've got a big pile of data and something needs to happen. So we've had, since 2012 when we started this, we've made 31 of these awards, funding about 50 informationists. I'd say 99% of those have been librarians who have been working directly with scientists. In my dream world, the next time those scientists apply for a grant, they would include that expert on their team along with everyone else. That's my dream world. I haven't gotten enough years of experience yet to prove it. And we are, this is a, I have a URL here, you'll have my slides, so you don't need to write anything down. So I wanted to tell you a success story from one of these. This is one of the original awards we made in 2012. Three librarians at the NYU Health Sciences Library were working with Dr. Schmidt on this research project that he had a grant for. And as part of their work, they developed a video. So I'm going to show you this video. You may have seen it before. You're going to have to see it again because I love this video. And as soon as I figure out how to make it work, you're going to see it too. Has everyone seen this already? Get ready for fun if you haven't.
Hello, my name is Dr. Judy Benign. I'm an oncologist at NYU School of Medicine.
Hello, Dr. Judy Benign.
I read your article on B cell function. I think that I could use the data for my work on pancreatic cancer.
I am not an oncologist.
I know that I think I could use the data for my work on pancreatic cancer. Do you have the data?
Everything you need to know is in the article.
No, what I need is the data. Will you share your data?
I am not sure that will be possible.
But your work is in PubMed Central and was funded by NIH.
That is true.
And it was published in Science, which requires that you share your data.
I did publish in Science.
Then I am requesting your data. Can I have a copy of your data?
I am not sure where my data is.
But surely you saved your data.
I did. I saved it on a USB drive.
Where is the USB drive?
It is in a box. It is in the box at home. I just moved.
But can I use your data?
There are many boxes. So many boxes. I forgot to label the boxes.
Hello again. Thank you for sending me a copy of your data on a USB drive. I received the envelope yesterday.
You are welcome, but I will need them back when you are finished. That is my only copy.
I do have a question.
What is your question? You might find the answer in my article.
No, I received the data, but when I opened it up, it was in hexadecimal.
Yes, that is right.
I cannot read hexadecimal.
You asked for my data and I gave it to you. I have done what you asked.
But is there a way to read the hexadecimal?
You will need the program that created the hexadecimal file.
Yes, I will. What is the name of the program?
Cytosynth.
I do not know this program.
It was a very good program. The company that made the program went bankrupt in 2007.
Do you have a copy of the program?
I do not use this program anymore because the company that made it went bankrupt. Maybe you could buy a copy on eBay.
I have good news.
You again?
I talked to my colleague. She knew a person with a copy of the software.
Then why do you need me? Everything you need to know about the data is in the article.
I opened the data and I could not understand it.
If you have the program, you will find it is clear.
Well, I noticed that you called your data fields Sam. Is that an abbreviation?
Yes, it is an abbreviation of my co-author's name. His name is Samuel Lee. We call him Sam.
I see. And what is the content of the field called Sam1?
Ah yes, Sam1 is the level of CXCR4 expression.
And what is the content of the field called Sam2?
That is logical if you think about it.
What is the content of the field called Sam2?
I don't remember.
What about Sam3? Is there a guide to the data anywhere?
Yes, of course. It is the article that is published in Science.
The article does not tell me what the field names mean. Is there any record of what these field names mean?
Yes. My co-author knows what the content of SAM2 is and SAM3. And SAM4.
Can I talk to your co-author?
I'm not sure.
I would very much like to talk to your co-author.
Well, he was a graduate student. He went back to China 2 years ago.
Can I have his contact information?
He is in China. His name is Sam Lee.
I think I cannot use your data.
You could check the article to see if what you need is there.
Please stop talking now.
Likes the idea of writing grants. grant applications. We have a recompetition coming of our infamous and famous, really, and well-respected institutional research training programs. That's the university-based programs in biomedical informatics. We compete them every 5 years. And so next year, there's an announcement coming out soon, a night guide that will tell the general timetable for how we're going to run the competition, so that everybody is starting at the same place, saying, okay, get ready, start getting their act together, find their platforms, etc. We will be reissuing our RFA on information supplements. We also have a grant program of resource grants for information resources to reduce health disparities. In this program, we put high value on having libraries involved and also minority-serving organizations, because after all, our goal is to improve the kind of information that's available to reduce health disparities. We also have normal NIH grants as well. We have research project grants. We have exploratory developmental grants for crazy ideas that might or might not work. We also have fellowship and career awards. And those are all on regular deadlines. So if NIH, if you go to the site, look at our site, give me the URL, you can find what the next dates are. So I think we're a pretty awesome library, and we have been, partly because for 30 years we had Donald Bloomberg as our director, and he was a very forward-thinking person. He retired in March, and the NIH director went, wow, I better form a committee, right, who can give me some advice about how to keep our library as forward-looking as it has been. So, the NIH director has an advisory committee. He formed a work group of that committee. And that group, as part of its thinking, put out what's called a request for information. That goes out in the NIH guide and invites everybody who's read it to send us your ideas about whatever we're asking. We asked for 5 questions. I'll show you what they are. We got 649 responses. Now, normally, the ones of these I've seen, you know, to get 100, it's pretty amazing. We see this as how important many different groups see the library. And here's who responded, generally speaking. Of course, lots of health sciences librarians and others responded. But so did researchers, emergency personnel. We have a lot of different audiences. That's true of many libraries, but particularly of us. And also many different institutions. Hospitals and companies, medical schools, we don't discriminate because we're a public library and we like having public sciences. So in the RFI, we asked 4 questions. We asked people, these different communities that are described here, to tell us about the parts of the activities of NLM that are most valuable to them now. And so they gave us questions. Comments in all of these different areas. And that doesn't surprise you because you know I already showed you. We have many different areas of activity. But I'm only going to highlight. So for each of these groups, there was a top 10 kind of. These are the top 10 things mentioned. Now, I think the first thing that jumps out at you is that not everybody loves the same stuff, right? Some people, look at value to health professionals. Does anyone in this room know what WISER is? Right, it's a wireless information service for first responders that's provided by our specialized information service, the same place that puts out ToxNet and the household products database. So we have many different kinds of things going on, and we were happy. Of course, there are some things that wouldn't surprise you. PubMed shows up across there. The PubMed Central, the full text article repository, shows up across there. But, you know, DocLine, that's interlibrary loan, right? Article delivery, you can see that the patients and the public aren't using that much. But there are other things that they, Medline Plus is number one to them. Question number 5 is the one that I was thinking about that I'm going to talk a little more about, which is how could NLM be better positioned, given the great place we are, right? How can we be better positioned entering the next decade? In relation to these areas, big data, data science, electronic health records, digital publications, those were just examples. So I'm going to highlight a couple of the themes that came back from people who said, this is the stuff we want you to think about doing. So in the area of biomedical informatics, increase your grant funding greatly. I love it when people say that. And broaden and deepen the portfolio so that there is more expansive work. Because with a small budget, you may be able to only fund one or two good projects where, you know, with a deeper budget, you can do more and you can have more alternate approaches tested. Fundamental and applied research, we do that now. We want to do more of it. We have a balance in our research portfolio between clinical and bioinformatics and public health and consumer information science. And we try to keep it kind of balanced, although I would say about the biggest part, 30 to 40% of our research funds go into clinical support of various types, clinical decision support, ways to help patients and doctors. They also said they'd like us to do a whole lot more training. And there was the kind of debate that you hear all the time. Shall we concentrate everything to do with informatics and data science in one place, or shall we spread it across NIH so that all the institutes stay invested? Right now, the way we're funding the data science initiative is that every institute has paid a tax into the pot, right? We all ended up, right? And the money is spent, and projects are assigned without regard to whether the scientific area is the area of that institute. So, for example, lots of the training grants in data science are assigned to cancer, who may or may, you know, that wouldn't have been what they would put their training money into, but this is because we're trying to broaden informatics sort of mainstream it across the matrix. There is also a lot of suggestions about things they hope we will do with big data. That we will start posting repositories and linking them with various things, with articles from which the data, that represent the data. Interesting ideas about discovery indexes for software and for data, and ways to cite data and software so that you get credit for them the same way that you do for an article that you've published. Because some people, in our field in particular, in informatics, if we were only to depend on citation rates, we couldn't really reflect the true outcome and output and impact of our scientists, because some of them don't. For one thing, the clinical people publish half as often as the bio do. And so that's one thing you have to account for, but it's also the way people use published information and build it. It's just different across different areas. And so, and if you build a resource, or let's say you build some sort of a decision support module that's incorporated into one of the major commercial health record systems, How are we going to reflect that in some useful way so that everybody knows the accomplishment? I mean, that's something that we have to think about because we're using public models. So the development of best practices for storing data, for linking data, and for developing data management plans and making sure that they're monitored, all of those are other things they hope the library would be involved in. This is that public. Lots of stuff they hope we will help with in terms of standards for electronic health records, which will help with interoperability when regions try to bring health information together so they can take a broader, more public health-oriented view. It's pretty hard, right? Because they aren't using the same systems. People don't call things. All of you who have been in libraries will know what I'm doing. But they also told us to keep putting effort into the enhancement of electronic. More stuff is coming into them. You know, the Human Genome Institute has a huge initiative to incorporate genome information into electronic health records. Your average patient is now, or not patient, inpatient, right? Who will have access to that health record may not have any clue what's going on, what that information means, and that's probably true of information that's in those records. The outside world would love for NLM to host a data set that researchers can use to improve natural language processing and text mining techniques in this, because electronic health record data, that's a complicated data set that has both structured and unstructured. Different places use different abbreviations, very complex. So that is all I want to say about what the outside world told this committee. But I want to pay tribute to the people at NLM who actually did the analysis of 649 sets of comments. And the three who are listed at the bottom are our newest NLM associate fellows. So they're fresh out of library school. We put them right to work as soon as they got there. Just giving you a hint of what it could look like. Now I want to spend a minute or two on the recommendations this committee made after they'd gotten all that input. Each of us who runs a division of NLM, got to go in and tell them what we thought the strengths and weaknesses of our division were, which was also fun, in 5 minutes, like you could say, which is very easy. We have a huge community of talented researchers and not enough money. So I can say that like in 30 seconds, and I did. So here are the recommendations. They started with this. They want to make sure we are continually evolving as we have. In the first health sciences library I walked into, Index Medicus existed, right? It was a huge, clumsy set of volumes. It took a huge space. We don't produce that anymore. We evolved long ago into an electronic approach. So assimilating and disseminating accessible, authoritative research findings and trusted health information, that's a core mission area that shouldn't change. This is a newer thing, to say that we should lead efforts to support and catalyze open science, data sharing, and research reproducibility, which you know is a hot topic in all fields of research right now, social science as well as biomedical science. This is my favorite. We should be the intellectual and programmatic epicenter for data science at NIH. We should strengthen our role in fostering future generations of professionals. And in all these areas, we're happy to see library science is listed, because you don't hear that phrase very much at NIH, but there is recognition that it's an important part of this team. And we should act like a library, right? We should maintain and preserve and make accessible information about what's going on now so future generations will have access to it. And then, of course, once we get a new leader, that person needs to evaluate the resources and people who are there and make some recommendations about what's really needed to accomplish this mission. So here's how I was feeling after I read this report, right? That's me and throwing lots of money into the hands of researchers and trainees who can move this field forward. I love this. And so I want to go back to this part for a second, because this is the part that affects my group the most, which is, here are some of the specifics in that report under that top level. One of them is to become the administrative home of this Big Data to Knowledge Initiative, which we are not. We're a part of it right now. It's run out of the office of the NIH director. So if that comes over into us, that means training and educational resources and software development that's now going on will be coordinated in a different way. And we will take a more active role in coordinating across the institutes to make sure that they have a voice, get to say what's going on, and they'll continue to issue their own funding announcements that incorporate data science and informatics. But we don't all want to be issuing the same one at the same time. And then also, they said they thought we ought to provide leadership in areas of data science that are critical to the NIH mission and topic areas such as precision medicine. And I want to take a sidebar over this, because I'm very excited about this area. And I want to encourage you to go to our NIH website. If you haven't already been following us, there have been a number of big meetings talking about precision medicine. The idea being that we could, well, part of it, there are two components. I'm only going to talk about this part. The idea is that if you could put together a million person cohort of sick and healthy Americans, right, of all different types, so that it's truly representative of our country's population, you could learn And you get the data from their electronic records, from their own personal records, genome data for them. You could really begin to learn why it is that some people do really well and some people don't on a particular therapy, or why some people who seem to have the gene that will give them Alzheimer's don't get it. If you have a large enough group to do that analysis, the idea is that we could really have precision therapies that are more tuned to the individual, which I think is a very exciting idea and is doable and will require a lot of data science and informatics before we get there, as well as policy change. So the idea, and from my way of thinking, when we get to that group of volunteers, because government's not going to come take your information, people will have to be willing to participate and agree to it. There are going to be people who will need our help meaning librarians and other people who are really good at explaining how to find and use basic information resources to answer their questions and to help them understand what's going on. So I see a huge need for that and a change in whether that would be in networks in public libraries, I don't know, but I can't see how it would not be needed. And I think we should jump into that. I'm trying to figure out how the library, I can make the rest of the library jump into it. So I'll just say a few things about data science, because BD2K, as we call it, our Big Data to Knowledge initiative. There was another committee of that working group of the NIH director back in 2012 that recommended that NIH needed to get its act together about data and informatics because it was just not coordinated. So it said, and it said we needed to do these things. They sound familiar to you by now, right? Promote data sharing, right? Support development and dissemination of methods and applications of informatics, build capacity in the workforce, and also put a whole lot more money into it. So after that was when they created this pool of funds. So there's about $100 million a year that has been pulled from the institutes and put into funding this through 2021. And so by then, we better find a way to make sure money is going to continue to flow. But that's the picture we have right now. And they made the point in this report that there is a need, that interdisciplinary team science is needed to do this work, and it requires an infrastructure and a set of policies and incentives that promote data sharing. So it isn't going to just happen because it's a good thing to do. It needs some assistance. And then they could see there are particular challenges when you're thinking about bringing together basic science and clinical data. And so that will also require some careful thinking of many information scientists and informaticians to integrate those things into meaningful databases that could then be the basis of new research. So this is the mantra: findable, accessible, interoperable, reusable, fair. Has everybody heard that? We'll hear it a lot more already. Because we talk about it all the time, and so does Europe. This is actually a concept that we're importing, because there are organizations in Europe that are already thinking about these things and are ahead of us in this. So our associate director for data science at NIH, his name is Phil Bourne, who's a respected scientist that we dragged into government to lead this initiative, has described this, what he calls this connected ecosystem of biomedical data and informational knowledge. And he talks about it, he has a nice piece or two on the blog, on his blog, that was, I have the URL in here. This long-term vision of the information commons, the NIH commons, whatever you want to call it, which would have data sets that have been funded by NIH, stored along with metadata about them, tools for using them, and analyzing them, and visualizing the data that's there, and the compute power that you would need to use this data if you wanted to, because not all organizations have access to massive compute power. Some kinds of big data science need that. And then the assigning for this to work well, you also have to have those unique identifiers. So you can find and cite and reuse them. When you've read something and you want to go back and use the data for your own research. So we have I'm working on a small group at NIH that is trying to think about how we make this ecosystem sustainable. Because right now, researchers create research data and then their grants run out, then what happens? Right? It depends, right? Sometimes the university has a repository and keeps it there. Sometimes they submit it to the protein data bank or some other community resource. Sometimes it disappears. So we think that we need, in a way, in my mind, of course, the model of how libraries think about their collections and what they save and store and manage, what the lifespan is of things, what kind of cooperative arrangements they have, and how much they're willing to spend. All of that is a mental model that could be applied here so that we can come up with some answers about how we are going to, if we think the data are important and you have to deposit it, because that's what the law says, right? If you get NIH funds, you have to share your data. How is that going to work? And who's going to pay for it? That's what we're trying to find an efficient way to do it. Because we can't just say, we'll pay for all of that. There won't be any money for research if we do that, right? So we have to find a way. And we're working on that. So if you want to know more and more and more, if you haven't already gone to datascience.nih.gov, you can learn a lot about new and funding announcements that are coming out. You can read Phil Warren and other people's blogs about exciting things that have gone on or upcoming or the ideas we're thinking about. In this coming fiscal year, which starts October 1st, we have $97 million going into these big data. Just by comparison, my grant budget is about $43 million, so that just tells you there's a chunk of money going into this special data science. And I want to talk to you about the areas that are highlighted here just a little bit. Because I don't think you need to hear about leadership, and we're also not putting any of that $97 million into paying our own salaries. Right? This is all for research and development. So one thing I think you may know if you've been following this is that so one of those five areas, sustainability, workforce development, discovery, policy leadership, is discovery and innovation. We funded 12 centers of excellence and also a data discovery center that is working on how to do that, how to set up the approach to being able to cite and discover that. This is the list of centers, and the reason, they're not all the same, right? Some are focused on genomics, one or two or three of them are focused on clinical information or linking clinical to genomic information. Every one of these has got lectures, hackathons, and courses going on that are accessible, many of them accessible, because they webcast them and share them with one another, and you can share them too. So it is worth thinking about how you might incorporate this into your own learning, because this is the world that is here. Education and the workforce and development and diversity. We have a number of things going on. Training grants, we have some open courses, short courses and open educational resources that have already been funded. And more things will come. I wanted to highlight, of course, you have one of our training grants right here at Chapel Hill. And congratulations on that, those who are involved. There have only been four of those awarded so far. I think a few more are going to be awarded this year. A couple of them are supplements to NLM training programs who are going to create data science tracks, and a couple of them are brand new training programs. There are also postdoctoral awards. So the training programs are always pre-doctoral, and the postdoctoral awards, then you get one of these, what we call a pay award, a career transition award. These could be straight out of, like, your brand new postdoc. Sometimes they're mid-career faculty, sometimes they're MDs who want to expand into this area. We've made 20 awards to date, and more of those will probably come. In the courses and resources, again, I'm emphasizing this because these things will all be available. All of them have to be accessible to the whole community of everyone. So in the data science area, there have been 19 awards already, and their curricula, Harvard's got to buy a curriculum in their HarvardX system. There are a bunch of MOOCs on different kinds of data. Oregon Health Sciences has got a basic informatics analytics skill course to help people build their skills. And these courses all have, they're like taking a class, right? It's an online class, like on Coursera or something. I want to highlight the other side of this slide, the research data management. These are educational resources that the National Library of Medicine is managing this. We issued the funding announcements and got the idea accepted. These are meant to be used by librarians or others to train themselves or to train their graduate students and faculty on the basics of research data management. Because if we want the whole country, right, we want data from all of those research grants all over the place to be available, we need a level field. And not all, you know, some health sciences libraries already do this stuff. Some research libraries do it. Some libraries don't do much of it. But their scientists could use some help. So we want to provide some resources that will help them. And we hope that the library community will jump on that and begin to develop and deliver more courses in the area of research data management sharing. So that's part of our role in this already. There are always BD2K upcoming events. There's a call for hackathon proposals out right now. There's a lecture on October 15th from the University of Wisconsin that's live streamed. So this is looking at privacy, which is a big complicated area. They're talking about computational phenotyping, using electronic health data to predict phenotypes. And so the issues of what you can and can't do with people's health data are big issues, especially if you're talking about sharing. So this might be a good one to watch if that kind of area interests you. In 2016, we know that there is still a couple, you have to hurry, right? There are still a couple of funding announcements that are open. A new one came out recently on targeted software tools and methods in particular areas. That has a closing date on October 6th, so that's coming up. There's another round of applications being solicited for these open educational resources. And that'll be the last of those two for a year or so which is a good thing. We need to look at what we've already funded, think about what the next needs are, hear more from the community about how things are working for them. I know this is timely. So I'm only going to say, while we're sitting there without a whole lot of money to spend, we won't be asleep. We're going to think about some things, probably hold some workshops. One of them is on reference data sets, like what that means, how we would define them. And this, again, goes back to that idea of the cloud. We have a cloud. You know, we have data sets, some data sets there that are just reference data sets, like that clinical data set I was talking about. We need to think about what that would mean, actually, and define some characteristics. And also, if we were going to give awards to people to help them prepare their data to go on to the cloud with this stuff, we need to know those parameters as well. So we will spend some time on that. We will get some policy and initiatives, probably a funding initiative going in the sustainability area that I talked to you about. And they're thinking about whether the next software issuance needs to be to help people harden software that they have created in academic, you know, as sort of research projects, to harden it up to make it usable by a larger community. That might be a topic. And then there'll probably be, workshop is a way NIH gets everybody's ideas. So we invite scientists to come and tell us what their needs are or give us advice about different areas. So some of these areas, data science, curriculum development, big data inference, data science and citizen science, which is a pretty interesting itself of people. If you've ever gone to patients like me, you know that there are patients already who share their data and do research studies in it. Very interesting. All right, I'm through with BD2K. I'm leading now. I'm going to try and sell you a car or two here. The Common Fund is a special pool at NIH of funds. Doesn't come out of my pocket, it's given to us as the right part of the budget. And there are grant programs in here. Nothing in the announcement says we want informatics applications. They say we want applications in engineering or in medicine or in biology or in proteomics. But you can apply. You just have to get past that. Don't look for a number that's exactly you. The thing about these, Pioneer Awards, or the New Innovator Awards are for early stage investigators, which means you're in the first 10 years since you got your PhD. Pioneer Awards are for people who've been either, they could be those people, they could be people who are senior, tenured faculty who just want to go off in some new direction. But these are, the great thing about these awards, I think, is that they provide 5 years of funding. So there's, you know, you don't have to scramble. Many grants only last 3 or 4 years. So to have 5 years is just a big idea. And for you, if you're a new investigator and you have a new job at a university, having 5 years of funding in your pocket is a wonderful thing. I'm convinced that that will really work. So I encourage you to think about these. In the time they've been making these awards, which is probably 7 years, we have managed, because I go cherry picking. I read every list of those scored reviews and pick ones that fit in Ellen's areas of interest. 4, maybe 3 in all that time have been in an informatics area that we could justify, say, we want to participate in this, manage it, and put some of our own money into it. I want to see more. We want pioneers. So I looked at you guys on that same map that I was looking at my own grant programs on. So this is the day I pulled those other charts. This is the chart I pulled for UNC Chapel Hill that shows only the 1,000+ active awards from NIH. Nice going. And about, you know, quite a lot of money, $500 million, in all of the areas of science. And then I also said, just give me the term informatics. Now, you know, informatics doesn't touch everything. Some people never even use that word in an information science application. But I put these up mostly to say that I know you have a great start already in the research that's going on here, both in your general area and the fact that you already have a lot of informatics research going on. So this world we're headed for, it seems like you're in pretty good shape, which is a good thing. I'm sorry, I always have to do this. I have to tell you, you know, you are welcome to call one of our program officers or send them an email and say, I want to talk to you about an idea I have. People have this idea that they can't talk to our program officers, which is that's what they're here for. They'll tell you, this doesn't fit our interests, here's how our reviewers would review this thing, and what they'd be looking for. They won't tell you what project. Sometimes people say, just tell me what you want, and I'll send you that application. We will not do that. We want your good ideas. And then on the other side of this slide, the project, the NIH reporter, is really a great tool. If you want to find collaborators in your own institution, if you want to find nearby people who are working in the same area, or if you want to see which of those really wealthy institutes is working in the area you're interested in. So if you're in visualization, like you are, you can search a tool like that and see all the different institutes and the kind of work they're doing. So that's, and if you haven't subscribed to the NIH Guide to Grants and Contracts so that you get that email every Friday, then you're missing an opportunity every Friday. Because I get it, and I work there. But that's how you know every time we issue a new announcement of any kind that's going to be possible, grant applications, deadlines, and all that stuff. I already told you about the data science site, MLM, my organization, extramural programs. We do have a site as well. So on our website, we have grant, a listing of the grants we've awarded back to 1997. So if you want to see the kinds of stuff, like if you're saying, I don't know if MLM really funds the kind of stuff I'm interested in, that's a, just sort of let your fingers and eyes do the walking on our list, and you'll have a sense of where our priorities are. Now, if that exciting future has sounded good to anybody here, or if you know anyone who that sounds like, I want you to recruit them to apply. This committee is going to start looking at applications on October 20th. And I want them to have fabulous applications from the extramural research community for our new director. And if you're the lucky person who gets to come run our spaceship, you know, what can I say? It's a great place to work. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Valerie. I'm sure there are some questions. We do have a reception, but we have a little time for Q&A. So I'll let you handle the questions.
Gary told me he thought I was giving three talks, and I was. So possibly more. I just tried to warn you when I was leaving what topic to go.
So I have a question about the Pioneer and Innovator Awards. Now those go to sort of standard programs. Can you, I mean, can you actually send those directly to NLM, or do you go to one of the other institutes?
So they don't go to any institute. They go to the, these two grants go to a special study section that is formed just for them. And actually, they do interviews. Once they have gotten down the ones that they think they want to fund, they have every single person has to come in and give a talk to this committee. So they go to a central place, and then we get to bid on them. So once they've been reviewed, every institute at NIH has a chance to go look and say, oh, this is in our area. In the case of the Pioneers, we cough up half the money after the first year. That's why I call that this, that's the deal, right? Oh, we'll pay the first year and you get the other four. Well, fine, you know, if it's in our area, that's a good deal, because it's exciting work. And then your Innovator Awards, they meaning the Common Fund, pays the whole thing for a scientist that's going to come into an area that we care about. So, it's efficient, it's efficient.
I have a question. Informed, because I'm just learning about this area now. And my name is Ines, or I have a background in public health. I work for the VA and do consultative research. And so I'm interested in this area of mining unstructured data, particularly as it relates to electronic medical records. Yeah. And I was wondering if you have any thoughts about that, about needs, and how to break data.
So we fund that kind of research and have for quite a long time. From, you know, it depends on, because most of all of our grant programs, unless we put out an RFA, these are just investigator-initiated ideas. So if you had an idea, like, you know, and public health working, for example, with electronic health, you know, with physicians to try and understand some things is a big area that the NLM has cared about for a long time. So my recommendation would be, if you have an idea that you want to try out, you would contact our program officer. He might say, if you can write it in a paragraph, send it to me, and then we'll have a telephone conversation about it, and I can give you some other ideas. Because that is a very, it's a very exciting area. And we have some, you know, we do have some research funded in the areas of natural language processing and understanding. We have someone right now, a new project at Harvard that's trying to look at how you search structured and unstructured at the same time. So, but that's the thing. There are many questions, interesting questions. And public health informatics, I'll just go that way for a second. I think that we probably fund more of it still than most other institutes. They will in terms of their own area. So mental health, as it applies to public health, right? They will fund something, but we do more general stuff. So, yes. I hope that answers.
Oh, yeah, it's helpful, yeah.
Okay.
When does that director job close?
When does it close? It stays open until they find the right person. And I'm hoping that will be forever, right, that we're waiting. Because, so they start looking at those applications in October, but they've said they will keep the position open until the decision is made.
It'd be hard to follow.
Well, there are good people and good ideas. You know, when Dr. Lindbergh came, people might have said, huh, right, to some of the things he said. So I think.
So how does the Pioneer Award that you started and differ from a K Award?
So a Pioneer Award, so K Awards are a career starter grant kind of, right? So they give you salary support, usually 75% salary support, plus a research fund to, in the bio side, they would say to build your lab. You know, we say it's a research fund, we'll use it however you need it. And so the good thing about those, of course, is just it looks good when you're new in a position, and sometimes people use that. So but there are many different kinds of K awards. You don't have to be at the start. There are some for people mid-career, but there are always career enhancement or transition. A Pioneer Award, you're supposed to take an area of research that is you haven't been working on. Some idea you have, I mean, of course it'll be related. You might not have the idea or have the resources to do it. So I'll tell you about one Pioneer Award that we had funded, our first one, was someone who wanted to build a fully functional model of a yeast cell, a computational model of a yeast cell. Almost impossible, and there weren't any such thing when he started it. So, yeah, he had a background, right? He was a computer scientist and had a biology background, but he didn't know how to do it. He just said, here's what I want to do. And it's a different kind of application. They want you to talk about, so, you know, usual applications have that, tell us your methods, tell us what the impact would be. This has more like an essay question, I guess I would say. But it's a, and so that's, I haven't looked at one of the applications in a while, but generally speaking, it's that. And of course, nothing stops someone from the beginning. This guy who did the computational model, the full model of the computational model of yeast, was pretty new. I mean, he was a postdoc, he might have been 3 or 4 years out, and then got this award. So now he's doing a whole bunch more stuff.
Valerie, you mentioned that there are smaller scale exploratory grants. Mm-hmm. So
I'd love to talk about those.
R21.
R21. So I come from NIH and we talk in mechanism numbers. So my previous boss, Dr. Lindbergh, used to swear at me when I did that because he says, I don't know what that is. So the traditional bread and butter NIH grant called R01, right, is a research project grant. But we also have this smaller, shorter grant. It's only 2 years. R21 is what we call it. And it is really a proof of concept kind of grant. The biggest difference for many people is you don't need to have preliminary data. So that is an important question. If you apply for a research grant R01 and you don't have any preliminary evidence of, you know, some early study, some publication, the review committee will not give you a good score. But in these R21s, that's not expected, because the idea is that you need to describe a project that convinces the reviewers that when you've finished it, you will know whether your idea is worth pursuing or not. So you have to be clear that way. And many people use it as the path to a research project, get their data that way. But in our study section, not every, you know, you have to read the funding announcements because sometimes different institutes are different. In ours, we really look for high risk, high reward. I don't mean risk like, you know, jumping off a building risk. I just mean it needs to be possible that it might not work, but if it worked, it would have great impact on the problems. And those are actually the only two research grants that we give, is the R01 and the R21. We give other kinds of career awards and training awards, and, but we just, because we want our field, we've been nurturing this field of biomedical informatics for 30 years, and we want money available for people who really want to do the early concept development and proof of informatics concepts and methods, which is still what nobody else funds other than NSF. Most of NIH doesn't. Had enough?